In the name of our risen Lord, I bid you a good morning. And this is a day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. My name is William Nickrand, and I have the privilege of serving as a pastor here at Pittsburgh United Methodist Church, where our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And our vision for living out that mission is to make God real by loving, connecting, and serving just like Jesus. And I pray a happy new year to you all. I hope you all are well. I hope you had Christmas celebrations as you were able, happy new year celebrations, and that you are entering into this new year ready to praise God above all else and to be renewing our spirits. Now, many churches this day, they spend this opportunity to renew their covenant with God, and I hope we can do the same as well on this Epiphany Sunday. A few quick announcements for you this morning. The first one is that our brand new 3-week sermon series entitled Healthy Living is beginning next week, and I hope you won't miss it. In the new year, everybody's wanting to be healthier. We're wanting to make better choices in this year, and as a pastor, I have some things I want to share, specifically from how the Bible says how we should be living healthy. And it's not just body, as you know, it's not just mind, but it's not just the soul. It's that incumbent of all that we are and how all that we are is connected to all that God is. So make sure you come back next week. Join us with our 3-week sermon series, Healthy Living. And I love to see you there. Now, in a couple weeks, we're going to be doing a call out. And this is we're going to see who is interested in being part of our confirmation class for 2021. If you have a student that is sixth grade or higher that has not gone through confirmation and would like to confirm their faith to learn more about United Methodist, about Jesus, about God, I encourage you to please come to this call out meeting. We're not sure if it's going to be Zoom or in person. I'd love for it to be in person, but as of right now, it is looking like Zoom, but we'll get all that information out another date. That is the 17th, right after the worship service. We'll try to do some type of a call out, see who's interested, talk about the agenda or the schedule, and going from there. So again, we're so glad that you have chosen to be in worship with us today, and let us now join together for these moments of worship.
Good morning. I am so glad to be able to be here with you in worship today. Join me in the call to worship. Arise, shine, for your light has come. We are called out of our darkness into light. Lift up your eyes and look around. We rejoice in the gift of light. Come, let us worship the God of light and joy and peace. We come to kneel at the cradle of the babe, the light incarnate.
Good morning, Pittsburgh, Indiana. My name is Lori Hayes, and I'm the worship leader here at Pittsburgh United Methodist Church. And as always, I am blessed to be with you all and joining you in worship this morning. May I start off first by saying Happy New Year to everybody, and I hope that your new year is filled with blessings, love, joy, and peace. Please join us this morning from home as the PUNC praise band brings to you God Rest You Merry Gentlemen, We Three Kings.
God rest you merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born upon this day. He saved us all from Satan's power. Right, blessed word of peace.
energy is really, really thick here. Please join me in the opening prayer. God of promise and light, open our eyes this morning that we may see your light in the darkness. Open our hearts that we may perceive your promises of justice and righteousness fulfilled in the babe of Bethlehem. May we, like the Magi, have a star to guide us on our journey quest to find the one who will truly set us free. May this time of worship bring us closer to you, that the good news of the birth of light and love will transform our lives. Amen.
It is now time to take up our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings. This is our opportunity to give back just a portion of the many blessings that our God has bestowed upon us. I do want to remind you that online giving is available at pittsburghumc.org/giving, and you can also mail in your tithes, your gifts, and your offerings. Let's pray. God of light and promise, we bring our gifts to further your work in a dark world, and may they bring your light to those overwhelmed by darkness, pain, and loneliness. Accept these gifts of money and time, indeed the gift of our very selves. Let them shine for all to see and be brought into the sphere of your love and righteousness. We pray all this in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Please join us in this morning. We're going to be bringing to you, Thy Word is a Lamp Unto My Feet.
Thank you.
Savior of all peoples, who took on our flesh in a stable and slept in an animal feeding trough. Sages followed a star to find you, paid you homage, and went home by another way. Be present among us. Encounter us in word and bread and song and prayer. Move within us. Change us. Send us out to walk in new paths, telling your story, proclaiming good news to the nations. Light of the world, shine upon us. Shine your light of hope into the corners of gloom in our lives and throughout the streets of our cities and towns. Shine upon those who are lost to show them a new path home. Shine upon those who are ill to give them strength to decide how they shall live whole lives. Shine upon those in despair who need to make a way out of no way. Shine upon those whose homes, families, and bodies that war has torn apart. Reveal a path to peace. And shine upon your creation, the earth and its creatures, things seen and unseen. Burn away the mist and let us see you face to face, so that you can wipe away our tears and make death to be no more. Light of the world, we praise your name and offer this prayer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Savior of all people.
Today's scripture is Matthew 2, 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men came from the east to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road.
Well, Happy New Year once again. We can already feel 2020 shrink away, and oh, does it ever feel so good. Today, in the life of the church and all around the world, followers of Christ are celebrating the day of Epiphany. Epiphany. Now, that is a word we seldom use, but this word Epiphany in a standard dictionary has two meanings. When capitalized, it refers to the manifestation of Christ to the Gentiles, which again is that fancy word we use for non-Jewish. And in lowercase, the term applies to any manifestation of a deity. but the word increasingly has been used as a reference and insightful to an insightful or dramatic moment that instills new spiritual insights, visions, or perspective. I talked a lot about this on my children's message. If you haven't seen that yet, go over to Facebook and check it out. Now, the Epiphany story offers a rich opportunity for insight into the quote-unquote wise men from the East. Their epiphany was the recognition that the prophecies of the Messiah had become a reality, and this epiphany as God, as Messiah, can still be available to us as a new beginning and as a renewal of our faith. Let's pray. Lord God, we're so thankful for these moments of worship, and we pray as we continue to meditate on your word, we pray that you would inspire us. We pray that you would encourage us, and that we'd be reminded that even though we often have to take other roads in this world, roads that we weren't prepared for, roads that we weren't ready for, that oftentimes roads that you have prepared for us and that you've shown us a better way. So Lord, soften our hearts and help us to draw closer to you this day. Amen. All right, so let's dive right in with the stars of our show. Get it? The wise men, stars of the show. All right, we'll move on. Now, despite singing, "We three kings," the Bible doesn't say they were kings or that there were three of them. Now, because there were three gifts, people have guessed there were three of them. Because they were gifts fit for a king, they've been called kings. But who were they? They were magi. Matthew Gospel tells us they were magi. It's the word that magic come from. Now, scholars tell us that originally in Persia, magi were dream interpreters. And by Jesus' time, the term referred to astronomers, fortune tellers, or stargazers. Now, in the law of Moses, God forbade the Jews to use the sun and moon and stars for anything but giving light and telling the time of day and the year. The penalty for breaking this law was at that time death. So Jews knew God would never use the stars to send a message, right? But here it is. Gentiles, foreigners, people who didn't even believe in their God, took to the road following a star to find their newborn king. Simply incredible how God continues to use and love, you know that song, Amazing Grace, wretches like us. How sweet it is to be loved by Jesus. Now, I digress. Now, the Magi went straight to Rome's puppet tyrant, Herod the Great, not so great, to ask him of all people if he knew where we might find the newborn boy who would be king of the Jews. Now, Herod proclaimed himself the king of the Jews and was given the title by Rome. That's not really where that title should come from. But even though he was a foreigner himself and only half Jewish, he was an apostate and a traitor in the eyes of the Pharisees and zealot parties. He was a powerful and heartless man who stole from the people. And that's not even the worst of it. Here we go. Get ready. He tortured whole villages, assassinated his opponents without hesitation, and held daily executions of anyone he feared was a threat to his power, even his own wife and three sons. His closest friends, and several counselors who had once had his trust. And you know what, my comic friends out there, and we thought the Joker, you know, Batman's nemesis, was bad. This is bad. Yikes. Now, you might ask, if the Magi knew how to read the stars so well, why did they go to Jerusalem instead of Bethlehem? Remember that in the scripture? But probably they made the kind of assumption. We know what assumptions mean, but I can't say that here. The kind of assumption we would make too. Would you look for a king in a stable? Or would you look for a king in a palace? It's common sense, right? We just need to use our common sense and we'll make it. It's true that the Magi brought common sense with them, along with their gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And I love, if you're Southern, it's myrrh. But their common sense, going to Jerusalem instead of Bethlehem, What did that almost cost them? It almost cost Jesus' life. It almost got Jesus killed. So Herod consulted the priests and scribes to learn where God's chosen, the Messiah, would be born. They told him in Bethlehem, only about 6 miles down the road from Jerusalem. Then Herod secretly asked the Magi when they first saw the new king's star, and without thinking, they told him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage. He said, so somehow they failed to hear the jealous fear behind his words. They came close to betraying the very one they came to find. So, all right, the star, right? We finally get to the star. The star guided them to the house of the child and his mother. Now, again, if you're like me, you really like the star in the story. I've got a Christmas light show, and our star, Beth, the star Bethlehem, she's the star of our show. We really like her, but there's a lot that we don't know about the star of Christmas. Many have theorized it to be a supernova, or the conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn, a comet, or even an angel being mistaken for a star. But I enjoy all these theories, but one of my favorites is the thought that the star was a very normal star, but through the eyes of the Magi, it was possible to be seen as a way to Jesus. Ooh, I think that'll preach. I like that one. I think I like this one so much because this is God's way of acting, isn't it? Utilizing normal and even broken things for incredible purposes. We will never know the full story of the Christmas star, but we do know that it led the Magi to Jesus. And Augustine once wrote this, Christ was not born because the star shone forth, but it shone forth because Christ was born. We should say not that the star was fate for Christ, but that Christ was fate for the star. Now, overwhelmed with joy, the Magi kneeled to pay homage. That's a word that we don't use a lot, but to pay respect, adoration. We learned that in the sermon series last year. I can say that now, last year. But they were overwhelmed with joy. The Magi kneeled to pay him homage and presented him with gifts. They brought gold and frankincense, but wait, there's myrrh. Get it? Because there's more, there's myrrh. All right, I couldn't resist. It's bad today. You're stuck. Sorry. So when the Magi arrived at the house where Jesus was born, they brought their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And traditional Christian interpretation has read the gifts as foreshadowing the child's life. God is fitting for royalty and gold. I don't know why I said God. Gold is fitting for royalty and frankincense for priestly duties. And myrrh points to the prophet's death he would suffer. And even more important than the gifts was the Magi's response to the child. They knelt down and paid him homage. In short, they were believers. Even though they were Gentiles from the East who practiced astrology, an activity considered a suspect by the Torah. But even though they were happy because they found the child they were looking for, their dreams were troubled by a warning. As they were led by a star, now they were led to see the lie in Herod's words. So they decided not to go back to Herod as he commanded them, but to go home by another road. And again, that part of the passage, going by another road, I think this is really going to speak to us in the new year. Joseph, too, was warned in a dream by an angel not to stay in Bethlehem and not to return home. So it's not going home to another road for Joseph, but they had to go to Egypt. So he and Mary had come. They couldn't go that way. Only by taking the child and fleeing to exile in Egypt did they save his life. The murderous Herod had all the boys under 2 in Bethlehem slaughtered in a mad and useless attempt to keep the title of king of the Jews for himself. Part of the story oftentimes we don't read. It actually wasn't in our reading, but it's right after our reading today, is about King Herod, just because of fear, just going crazy and killing all these newborns all the way up to 2 years old in Bethlehem and around. It's just awful part of the story. And you see, sometimes the weariness and burdens of this world comes crashing upon us, and we are forced and or delivered, in this case, to go another way, even if it is a way even if it's away from the only home we've ever known, that God can make a home in other places for us. That's kind of the cool thing about God, is that when we mess things up and we think we have a better understanding of what home is, God says, nope, I got this, watch this. Now, there's a song by James Taylor entitled Home by Another Way. The first part of this song reads, those magic men, the magi. Some people call them wise or oriental and even kings. Well, anyway, those guys, they visited with Jesus. They sure enjoyed their stay. Then warned in a dream of King Herod's scheme, they went home by another way. Yes, they went home by another way, home by another way. Maybe me and you can be wise guys too and go home by another way. We can make it another way. Safe home, as they used to say. Keep a weather eye to the chart on high and go home another way. Stay clear, steer clear of royal welcomes. I thought that was pretty good, really relevant to what we're talking about today. And if we read between the lines of Matthew's story of the Magi, we can find another meaning in the words. They went home by another way. The first Christians who followed Jesus weren't called Christians, but followers of the way. The Magi went home changed. They weren't the same people they were when they set out on the road to find Jesus. They didn't believe the same, and they were wiser now. They went home in another way, to another way of life. They found the king they were looking for, but not looking for. They found out their assumptions were all wrong. They found the king on God's terms, not their own. This is hitting a little too close, isn't it? But what God revealed to them by the star and through the Hebrew scriptures, they found the king of the Jews, who was to be king of the Gentiles, their king too. Remember, Gentiles, non-Jewish, so king of all. Now, if God could show them, foreigners and unbelievers, the way to Jesus, then there's hope for all of us, isn't there? There's hope for all people to find our way to Jesus. That's why we're here. Now, this is a hope I pray for you here in today's scripture, that God truly can make another way in your heart, mind, and in your life. God has forever changed my life, and because he lives, I can face tomorrow. No, I'm not going to sing it. And whatever troubles might come my way, we can face them with God's help. So going home by another way doesn't mean going to a place or a house. It's about who we are. It's a place where we belong, the place where we dream, the place where we find the center of our soul, our truth and purpose and meaning. The places where we are vulnerable, uncomfortable, fearful, in the community of faith. Home is a place of peace. Going home, we become like the Magi, peoples whose hearts and minds are open to what we never would have imagined, never would have expected before setting out on this journey together. There's a story of a couple who were planning their wedding with their pastor and requested the wise men story. It's today's scripture, and to be read at their ceremony. Seeming to be an odd choice, the pastor inquired as to why they would pick this passage and not the love passage from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And they replied, there was something about the Magi's heading home by another way that struck a deep chord with them. They said, you see that their relationship had been established in difficult circumstances and regrettable choices. They needed redemption. I mean, that's what this whole Jesus stuff's about, right? They needed redemption, which brought them to the church. Home represented not the place they needed to return to, though, but a place they needed to get to. And they realized that getting there would require going some other way than the way they'd been traveling. So this other way ended up as a humbling encounter with God and God's grace. Christians know it as the way of the cross, a way that contradicts every human assumption about home and grace, as well as about lost and found, about weakness and strength, and about leastness and greatness, about first and last, about death and life. We talk about how God turns everything upside down. The cross does not reward you if you are good, but precisely because you're not. That's why the cross is there. Edith Stein, many of us know this name, but Edith Stein, a Jewish convert to Christianity who died at Auschwitz, wrote that the way from Bethlehem leads inevitably to Golgotha, from the crib to the cross. The star of Bethlehem shines in the night of sin. I really like that one. And the shadow of the cross falls on the light that shines from the crib. And the way of the incarnate Son of God leads through the cross and passion to the glory of the resurrection. In his company, the way of every one of us, indeed of all humanity, leads through suffering and death to this same glorious home. All right, so T.S. Eliot imagined the thought of the Magi back home. They said, "We return home to our places, but no longer at ease here in the old dispensation with an alien people clutching their gods." Now, most of us have followed Christ long enough that we know for a fact that Jesus does not make our lives more comfortable. Jesus doesn't help us fit in and succeed. If anything, because of our faith, we are no longer at ease in a world not committed to Christ. We notice sin everywhere, and nothing is the same. Nothing comes easy. A strange, unfamiliar road is now our path, but the road, it's going somewhere. Does this sound familiar in your life? Does this seem relatable to you? You see, we find ourselves on a strange and unfamiliar road, but God has got this. No matter where you are this day, I pray you would know the love of our God who has and will forever call us home in God's own grace and love. So what do you say? Let's trust in our God and go home by another way, God's way. Amen. Well, happy.
There's a little flame inside us all. Some shine bright, some shine small. The rains will come and the waters rise. But don't you ever lose your light. In this life you will know love and pain, joy and sorrow. So when it hurts, when times get hard, don't forget whose child you are.
There will be
Receive now this benediction. May God's light inspire you. May God's angels guide you. May God's love protect you. And may Christ our Emmanuel dwell within you this day and forevermore. Go in peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, Amen.
This little life.